going to be all right.
What is going on?
We're getting into trouble.
What is it?
We're getting out of control.
It was going to be all right from the beginning. What are you talking about?
Let's get him out of here.
It'll be all right.
No. No, it isn't going to be all right.
Follow me, I'll get you through.
Boy's dead, all right.
How did it happen?
The usual thing. They say he attacked the police. Others say he came out with his hands over his head. What happened?
Yeah, that's what nobody seems to know.
You told us it was all in hand. Now, we prepare for these things, you know.
I have never seen most of the men who were pushing Dr. King.
What do you mean you've never seen them before?
That's what I mean. Some of them I have never seen before.
Where's Martin?
He's in there. I've never seen him so depressed. I'm afraid for him, man.
There's reason to be depressed. Can you imagine what the hyenas of the media are going to make out of this?
In Memphis, people were injured. Stores were looted. Property was destroyed. Terror reigned in the streets. People were beaten by hoodlums. At least one Negro youth is known to have been killed. And massive rioting erupted during a march which was led by Martin Luther King. It was a shameful and totally uncalled for outburst of lawlessness, undoubtedly encouraged, to some considerable degree at least, by his words and actions. And I hope that well-meaning Negro leaders and individuals in the Negro community in Washington will now take a new look at this man who gets other people into trouble and then takes off like a scared rabbit. Martin Luther King fled the
city. So happy.
He took to his heels and disappeared, leaving it to others to cope with the destructive forces he had helped.
They're destroying him, Arthur. I knew they would. And they're doing it.
Dad, you have to control yourself. You can't let him see you feel this way.
How can you be nonviolent with such brutes? Such scoundrels? You have to show them that you know what they are. You've got to stand up to them.
Go to him and ask him to come out.
I can't. He won't listen to me anymore. I can't. I can't go in there to him. I have a beautiful son, and they're destroying him. I knew they would.
It wasn't your fault.
Yes, it is.
How can you say that?
I shouldn't have allowed one person to march in that protest unless it accepted nonviolence. I should have understood depth of those young people's bitterness towards me.
Martin, you can't be responsible for every demonstration that goes wrong in this country.
And what Bird said on the floor of the Senate, that I was responsible for people being killed, that I lovingly break the law like a boa constrictor.
Now, since when have you cared what he says about you?
It isn't him, Corey. It's others. It's our own young people that hurt the most.
Are you going to Louisville?
I have nothing to tell him.
Martin, these are the same people who have always attacked you. They're the ones who never fought till you spoke up. They just want to be Martin Luther King. They're not offering anything constructive, you know that. And you know what they are.
Maybe I should let them have their way. Maybe we should let violence take its course. I know it's wrong. I know it's not going to work, but maybe it has to be.
I've never heard you talk like this before. He's not going to Louisville.
The way he's been acting these last couple of days is just as well.
The poor people's march becomes all the more important now.
Becomes all the more important to drop. Maybe he's got to go back to Memphis. I suppose he's got to prove that nonviolence isn't dead.
Why does he have to prove it?
I know you never believed
it. You damn right I never believed in it. That's a tactic I went along. But believe it, what kind of an idiot you think I am?
How does he feel? How do you expect him to feel? 12 years he's been at it. The man's exhausted.
So that's all it was. 12 years. 12 years to change what had existed for centuries. 12 years to go from Montgomery to relationships with presidents. To challenge them. Sometimes to gain their friendship and then their hatred. To have your house bombed, to be stabbed. To be arrested more than 120 times. Would we have done it again if we knew what it would cost? And how did it begin?
Hello, this is M.L. King, Jr.
M.L. King? Be nice to me.
Well, a mutual friend of ours, Gloria McGrew, well, she's been telling me some very wonderful things about you.
Well, yeah, well, that's nice. Yes, I've heard some nice things about you, too.
Well, thank you. Every Napoleon has his Waterloo, and I have the feeling I'm about to approach mine. Now, when am I going to be able to see you?
Well, I don't know. My evenings are pretty full this week.
How about lunch?
I'm free between 12 and 1. I'm between classes.
Well, great. Then I'll meet you on the Huntington Avenue side tomorrow. I have a gray Chevy, and it usually takes me 10 minutes to make the trip from Boston University, but tomorrow I'll do it in 7.
It's nice of you to try to play Cupid for me, but it would also be nice if you let me know in advance.
Haven't you ever heard of M.L. King Jr., son of Martin Luther King Sr.?
Who is he?
You haven't heard of Martin Luther King Sr.? He's the most well-known minister in Atlanta. He's on the board of the first black bank there.
Oh? And what does his son do?
He's studying to be a minister, too.
Oh, that's all I need is a Baptist preacher.
M.L. King, Jr. I'm really glad that you don't have a delicate appetite.
It's usually peanut butter and graham cracker sandwiches for me.
Oh, excuse me. Have you tried the pecan pie here? They got the best pecan pie you've ever seen since you left home.
Don't bother.
Yeah, there's two of them. Thank you. One for now, one to take home later.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure just to watch you eat.
You're making me feel a little self-conscious.
Where are you from?
A small town just outside of Marion.
Where?
Heiberger.
Heiberger.
So funny about that.
You know one of my favorite stories is about Heiberger? Let me tell it to you. These two guys from Heiberger steal his pig, see? And in their getaway car, and the police car comes over and pulls them over to the side. So the first guy says, oh, Lord, what are we going to do about this pig? So the other guy tells him, just put your hat on it. Well, the cop comes over and he says, let me see your license, boy. So the guy in the back is trying to keep the pig quiet, but wouldn't you know that pig makes a noise? So the cop goes around to the back, and he says, what's your name, boy? And the guy tells him, listen, I said, well, what's your name? And the guy makes the pig make a noise. So the cop goes back to his partner at the car. He said, you know something? I've always known that niggas were some ugly damn creatures. But you know something? There's one nigga sitting in the back of that car named Oink who's the blackest, ugliest, damnedest nigga I ever seen in my life. I always thought that was a very funny story. What are you majoring in?
Performing arts.
That's right. Yeah, Gloria told me you were studying music. What you gonna be, another Ella Fitzgerald?
I want to be a concert singer.
Really? Wow. Boy, that's wonderful. You know, I never met a concert singer.
Well, I'm really not quite one yet.
Where have you sung?
I gave a concert in Marion. They seemed to like me.
Well, it must take a lot of courage just to say, I'm going to be a concert singer. What made you decide that?
I went to see Paul Robeson. Came to Antioch, you know? Some of the people in the town were afraid to go to see him. I suppose they felt that they would be thought as his communists. Imagine missing a chance to see Paul Robeson because of his politics.
So you thought of other things besides music?
Didn't you think I would?
You know, I'm probably going to marry you.
What are you talking about?
It's probably just the way it's going to happen.
Well, I'm glad you think so, since you don't even know me.
I have everything anybody would want. Courage, beauty.
Listen, please don't feel you have to use those silly little compliments on me. I'm not a silly little girl. I'm a grown woman.
You are beautiful. Don't you think you will?
No, I don't.
You've heard a lot, haven't you?
Well, let's just say I'm tired of being an experimental student.
Oh.
Oh, you know what it's like. Everybody thinks you're so nice and that you're an exception. Why can't other colored people be like you? Huh. There's this Jewish boy, though. He seemed to be different. I mean, it wasn't anything serious. We were just good friends. One day, a bunch of us jumped into a station wagon to go to a music festival in there, Wheeling. And when we got to the city limits, he telephoned his folks. We were supposed to have dinner together. I asked him if he told them that I was Negro, and he said, what for? Well, when we got to the restaurant, we had to go upstairs to a special room because I was with him. I just saw his courage
evaporated. And then, of course, there was not room enough at the house to put us up for the night. He just didn't have the guts. Well, I know that I'm going to have to put up with this for the rest of my life, but nobody is going to make me feel that it's right.
No. Don't ever feel that it's right.
What about you?
Well, I was pretty secure on Auburn Avenue in Atlanta. See, my dad was kind of a hero there, but I guess the first time that anything happened to me was when I started to school. I went home with this white boy, and I was pretty shocked when his mother wouldn't let me in the house because I was black.
Oh, you'll do all right. Ministers always do.
You don't care very much for ministers, do you?
Well, maybe it's just the ones at home. They always seem to care more for their parishioners' souls rather than if they have enough at home to eat.
And is that all you dislike about them? What about their cowardice? What about their upholding the status quo? What about them turning religion into the very opposite of what it's supposed to mean? You know, Arthur Rubinstein is giving a concert this Friday at the Symphony Hall. May I take you? I know you may not care very much for me, but you're bound to like the music.
My father said that he heard your father preach at Ebenezer Baptist Church.
Uh-huh.
He said it practically changed his whole life. Emil, where do you get your clothes? Emil always looks like he just walked out of a band box.
Look so bad yourself there, John. Excuse me just a minute. I'll be right back. Excuse me, John.
You really enjoy them clustering about you like that, don't you?
I enjoy it very much.
Beatrice is a very beautiful girl, isn't she?
Yes, she is. You know, I think she's the most beautiful woman I've ever seen.
Why did you bring me along?
Well, I just wanted to show you that there are some young ladies who just cannot resist M.L. King, Jr. I was beginning to think I'd lost my touch.
There's a rumor about town that you're engaged to a girl in Atlanta.
I am.
Why did you say you're probably going to marry me?
Because I hadn't met you when I got engaged.
Why do you want to be a preacher?
I come from a long line of preachers. Oh, my daddy's a Baptist preacher, my granddaddy was a Baptist preacher, my uncle's a Baptist preacher, and my brother is studying to become a Baptist preacher.
That's not a very good reason.
You want some more punch?
Oh, yes.
You know, just because religion isn't used the right way doesn't mean it can't be.
Well, how can it be used?
You talked about Paul Ropes, and you work with the Progressive Party, but to really follow the precepts of Jesus would probably be the most dangerous, most revolutionary thing in the world.
Are you going to try it?
Yeah, I'm just a middle-class preacher, son. But if anything is going to stop without people, it's going to have to be through the church.
What do you mean?
Well, it's all our people have. It's about the only thing they can call their own, and it's the only place where anybody's going to be able to reach them.
I've thought about it a great deal, haven't you?
I even know the kind of congregation I want. It has to be a large one, so it has an impact on the community. And it has to be in the South.
Oh, why the
That's where I'm from. And that's where they need me the most.
You're so bright, seems to me you'd be able to do anything you want to do. In the South, you'd just be another black man.
Mm-hmm. Well, you see them guys standing over there? Now, those are the most improbable white men you ever see in your life. They are so busy running away from everything that they are. Well, I'm not going to run away from the South and the people that I've known all my life. I have no ambitions outside of being a good pastor. I enjoy pastoring. What's the matter?
I'll never be the kind of wife you want. I'll be your girl while school ends. And then we'll go our separate ways.
I feel too strongly about you. Don't you feel that way about me? Could you take it if we separated?
Martin, you're asking me to give up my life. To give up everything that's important to me.
And the last thing in the world I need is an emancipated woman who wants to sing at the Metropolitan Opera Company. Sometimes life doesn't give us any choice.
But it does. You always have a choice.
Maybe you are. Perhaps we should just stop seeing each other. I'm going to Atlanta next week. I want you to come with me to meet my parents, or I'll never see you again.
The Bible refers to prayer about 500 times. To faith, less than 500. And to material possessions, about 1,000 times. Now I wonder if anybody ever said to Jesus, Lord, you emphasize money too much. I think amen belongs in there somewhere. Amen. Now, I have asked you all to sign your names on these envelopes in which you put your contributions. And I've been checking up on you. Brother Perkins, do you think a man with a business like you have can only afford to give $15? And what about you, Brother Washington?
I understand that you are a singer.
That's right.
Do you know there's a bomb in Gilead?
Well, I'm studying to be a concert singer.
A concert singer? The only way you can help my son is to sing in the choir.
Well, I can sing in the choir and still have my own career.
Have you talked to her about this?
Well, Dad, what about Adam Clayton Powell and Hazel Scott now? They're doing fine nowadays.
You ain't Adam Clayton Powell. And she's not Hazel Scott as far as I can see. Not yet. How well do you know this young man?
Well, we've known each other a few months.
He will give the last penny out of his pocket to any beggar coming down the street if you don't watch him. He doesn't understand about money. He never has. He doesn't understand that money is freedom.
It can be. It can also make you a slave.
He's gone out with the finest girls. Beautiful girls. Intelligent, fine families.
I'm sure he has.
He gets serious every other week. Now, we love him. We like to be nice to everyone. But we don't know how to act.
It must be very difficult for you.
There's one girl. A girl from one of the finest families in Atlanta. We've grown to love this girl. She has a lot to offer.
I have something to offer, too. You didn't say a word during all that. He embodies in one person everything I've ever tried to run away from. I mean, you heard his sermon.
Oh, he is a tyrant, all right, but he's a lovable tyrant.
I don't find him so lovable.
His father was a sharecropper. And one of his duties was to curry the mule. He had to go to school, you know, with the hairs of the mule and the smell of the mule on him. Well, the kids would make fun of him. He said, well, I may look like a mule. I may even smell like a mule. But I don't think like a mule. Well, he came to Atlanta with 15 cents in his pocket. He married the most prominent minister's daughter. Not only that, he ended up taking over his father-in-law's congregation.
I don't find that so admirable, Martin.
He's also never let anybody call him boy. He's never ridden on the back of a bus, and he has done more in this town to break segregation than any other clergyman.
Well, why don't you marry him?
Corey, don't you think I know his faults better than anybody? I've seen him be a terrible taskmaster with my brother. I've seen him dominate my sister's life. Well, he's my father. And I can't change that now, can I? And I love him. I love him very much.
Are you sure he won't dominate you?
Corey, nobody is going to dominate me. And I'm not going to change anything by standing up to him and proving that he is wrong. See, time will do that. And I know that in time, he'll be a big enough man to admit that he's wrong.
Must be very hard on you working and going to school at the same time.
No. Not so hard.
Have some coffee.
All right. You're gonna be in the family.
Well, I hope you're going to accept me as that.
I accept you because you're his choice. I respect his opinion and his choice.
My name is Rosa Parks. Many people have questioned why I refused to give up my seat on that first day of December, 1955. Some said we staged my arrest because I was a member of the local NAACP. Some said it was because of the bus driver who had put me off the bus years before. Others said my feet hurt and I was just too tired to get up. Yes, I was tired. But I had been tired before.
Y'all better make it light on yourself and let me have your seat. I said to get up. You gonna get up? Because if you don't get up, I'm gonna call that policeman out there and have you arrested.
Go on and call him. There's a word called zeitgeist, which is the force that brings together destiny and time. After witnessing and suffering years of indignities, the spirit of time had tracked me down. I simply had had enough.
Did the driver ask you to stand up?
Yes.
Why didn't you stand up?
Do you think it's right that I should have to stand up after I got on the bus and took a seat?
I don't know, but the law is the law, and you're under arrest.
I'll pay Mrs. Fox's bill. Read what you have. Another Negro woman has been arrested and put in jail because she refused to give up a bus seat. Don't ride the bus to town, to work, to school, or anywhere on Monday. If you work, take a cab, a share ride, a walk. Come to a mass meeting Monday at 7 p.m. at the Holt Street Baptist Church for further instructions.
Whose names go on it?
No names have to go on it.
Don't they?
This is a secret committee. Nobody knows we're here except us. White people don't have to know who the members of the committee are. That way, nobody gets hurt.
That way nobody gets hurt, huh? Look, for years, washwomen been putting their money in the church, and you people never done anything for them. Well, now you got your chance to do something for them. We're gonna have to select a president. My choice is Reverend King.
Why me?
Well, I thought about it a long time. You're going to be the president.
Mr. Corbin, I've been in this community less than a year.
That's why the establishment hasn't had a chance to get to you.
And that's the best reason you have for selecting me.
You're also one devil of a speaker.
Mr. Corbin, things are very hectic at my house right now. My wife just gave birth to a baby. There are some programs.
Turn down your chance to be president of the NAACP here, too. What's the matter with you?
There's nothing the matter with me. I just feel there are others better qualified.
What do we have here? A bunch of scared boys? Or grown-up men? Of course, I always knew that all preachers are interested in is what's on the collection plate.
Beg your pardon?
I said I always knew that all preachers are interested in is what's on the collection plate.
I nominate Reverend King for president.
How you doing?
I'm paralyzed.
You're a good speaker. You're the best speaker I know.
It'd be so easy to let my Baptist fervor just run amok. Tell them to go out and fight and let the same kind of violence break out that's broken out every place else, and things just return to what they were before. Yeah, it's easy to give that kind of speech.
Well, what would you like to tell them?
Talk about the things we've talked about for a thousand times. You know, I would like to tell them about Mahatma Gandhi. And now he challenged the entire British Empire without a sword and won. I'd like to tell them about the power of unearned suffering, about the uses of nonviolence. Going about the right to do it. How can I keep up their passion for justice without letting them do the most natural thing in the world, which is to strike back? I'm inadequate to it. Yes.
There's a crowd two blocks long around his church. You better go.
I haven't written my speech yet, sir.
Well, you just have to finish it on the platform. Just open your mouth. Let God speak for you.
The last time I opened my mouth and waited for God to speak for me, not a damn thing came out.
We are here this evening because of the bus situation in Montgomery. We are here also because of our love for democracy, because of our deep-seated belief that democracy transformed from thin paper to thick action is the greatest form of government on earth.
Yes, sir. That's right. That's right.
And we are determined.
Determined.
To apply our citizenship to the fullness of its meaning.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's right.
On so many occasions,
Negroes have been intimidated and humiliated and oppressed because of the sheer fact that they were Negro. Just the other day, one of the finest citizens in Montgomery, not one of the finest Negro citizens, but one of the finest citizens in Montgomery, was taken from a bus, carried to jail, and arrested. Because she refused to get up and give her seat to a white person. And because she refused to get up and give her seat, she was arrested. Well, you know, my friends, there comes a time when people get tired of being trampled over by the iron feet of oppression. When people get tired of being flung across the abyss of humiliation where they experience the bleakness of nagging despair. There comes a time when people get tired of being shoved out of the glittering sunlight of life's July and are left standing amidst the piercing chill of an alpine November. And we are here this evening because we are tired now. My friends, we are not advocating violence. Don't let anybody make us feel that we are to be compared in our actions with the Ku Klux Klan or the White Citizens Council. There will be no crosses burned at the bus stops in Montgomery. There will be no white people taken out of their homes and taken out on some distant road and murdered. But I want it known that we are going to work with grim determination to bring justice on the buses in Montgomery. And we are not wrong. And we are not alone in what we are doing. If we are wrong, then the Supreme Court of this nation is wrong. If we are wrong, then the Constitution of the United States is wrong. If we are wrong, then God Almighty is wrong. Jesus of Nazareth was merely a utopian dreamer and never came down to earth. If we are wrong, then justice is a lie. And we are determined to work here in Montgomery until justice reigns over.
Yes, sir, in the future.
Somebody will have to say, there lived a race of people.
Yes, sir.
A race of black people.
Yes, sir.
Who had the moral courage to stand up for their rights.
Yes,
and we are going to do that.
Yes.
And God grant that we do it before it's too late.
Yes.
Good, but let's wait till the next one, all right?
Another one!
Very encouraging.
Yes, yes, of course.
not sorry for the way I look. I was just giving the baby a bath.
Now, this is Mr. Levison.
How do you do?
How do you do? Why, where is Dr. King?
He's in the kitchen.
Sir?
Yes, please.
Thank you.
Did you have some of this phone, sir?
I have a moment.
Have a piece of that.
Thank you. No, I'm skipping. Thank you.
Dr. King? Yes, I'm Dr. King. You photograph somewhat older than you look. I'm Damon Lockwood. I'm a lecturer, writer.
Yes, I know who you are. Welcome to Montgomery.
Thank you. This is Mr. Levinson. He's an attorney and
how do you do?
Veteran of the labor movement. Mr. Levinson had a Ford franchise during the war. So he's got more than enough to get by on. Strangely enough, he wants to help us.
Well, somebody get these gentlemen a chair. Thank you. Listen, would you like some of these chillers?
No, thank you.
Thanks. Delicious. Mrs. Bolson, best will you forgive me if I just go right on ahead?
Well, we're, down here to really try to help make this thing work. This movement has accomplished something that's never been done in the South before.
What's that? It's accomplished a boycott. Boycott is the most powerful weapon, if someone can use it. It's never been used in the South before.
The main business at hand is to get the boycott a little more publicity. You've got a good start, but maybe we can keep it going.
What do you suggest?
Demand that the president come down here.
Is the president coming down here?
No, of course not, but the mere fact that we're asking him will be news.
What are your plans, Dr. King?
Well, the mayor and the city council have asked for a meeting. I think we'll find some accommodation.
Well, don't be surprised if it doesn't work out that way. You know that people don't give up their privileges unless you force them to.
Well, Dr. King, we better get ready to go to church for our social life.
You're right, we're all going to be late. Well, you excuse me, gentlemen, won't you? We just came down from New York. This won't take long. Just make yourself to home.
All
right.
See
you
later.
Glad you enjoyed
the
chillin',
Dr. King.
Oh, I can tell you
isn't it? What?
That this hayseed has the power to move these people the way he does.
Are you sure that's all he is?
Are you?
I don't know. People have a disquieting habit of surprising my assessment of them all the time.
You saw the way he attacked them chitlins, didn't you?
Sounds a little racist, Damon.
Is it? Maybe I am. I'm black, but I never really have understood my people. And what other people would have stood for all this and not fought back? It's almost saintly. And to be saintly is stupid.
There couldn't be a note of envy there in your judgment of Reverend King, could there be?
Of course there is. I've spoken in half the universities of this world. I know every phase of black history. I know exactly what should be done. And I can't reach and move these people the way he can.
Who's the spokesman? Who's the spokesman? All right, come forward and make your statement.
We have three requests. One, first come, first serve seating arrangements with Negroes loading from the back and whites from the front. Two, a guarantee of courtesy from the drivers. Three, that Negroes be hired as drivers on predominantly Negro routes.
That seems reasonable enough, doesn't it?
I don't see how it can be done within the law. If it were legal, I'd be the first one to be for it. But it isn't legal.
If we granted the niggers these demands, they'd go about boasting of a victory they won over the white people.
Your Honor, I object to the presence of Mr. Hubers here, a member of the White Citizens Council. Now, how are we going to make progress with a self-proclaimed racist?
He has as much right to his point of view as you have.
I resent the implication of Dr. King's remarks. Well, he's saying that this council is meeting with a closed mind.
As a matter of fact, there are people in Montgomery, black people, who think your role as spokesman is responsible for the boycotts not being settled, Dr. King.
Dr. King represents the Negro community of Montgomery. We have belief in him. He has our entire confidence. He speaks for us.
We are certainly willing to guarantee courtesy, but we cannot change the seating arrangement because such a change would violate the law. And as far as bus drivers are concerned, we have no intention, now or in the foreseeable future, of hiring Negroes.
Dr. King, I always thought the job of the minister was to lead the souls of men to God, not to become involved in petty social problems. I would remind Dr. King of the season approaching, and I urge him and the other Negro ministers to leave this meeting determined to end the boycott and lead their people instead to a glorious experience of the Christian.
How did it go?
Not too well.
I told you it wasn't going to be easy. But a Southern City Council did meet with a black protest group for the first time, and that's some kind of progress.
The demands that we made were so modest. But worse than that, I felt like such a fraud up there. You know, I felt like I wasn't equipped to speak, that I had no right to speak. I realize now that if we are going to make any kind of progress, we are going to have to squeeze a slave out of ourselves. And I haven't squeezed it out of myself yet.
Yogi, she's such a devil. You know, whenever she gets ready to burp, I know she gets a strange little smile on her face. I can see it coming. I just get... What's that? Just move to the back.
Reverend King, we have something to take. Bombed your house.
Corey!
Brian, I love you.
Corey!
Thank you, all right?
Corey, are you all right?
I'm all right. I'm all right. I'm
what
fine.
About your luggage?
Yoki's all right.
Oh.
It's all right.
What?
I did it, and I'm just sorry I didn't kill all you bastards.
I'm sorry.
It's too late to be sorry. This is a result of your get tough policy.
We're going to have to call out the militia unless we can get some help from Dr. King.
So now you're asking Dr. King for help. Would you come outside with me, please, Dr. King?
To me. If you have weapons, please take them home. If you don't have them, please don't get any. I'm all right. My wife and my baby are all right. And Jesus still speaks to us across the centuries. Love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. And pray for them that despitefully use you. Please, go home. Oh, all right.
God bless you, Dr. King. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
You.
Dr. King.
Dr. King.
Dr. King.
Dr. King. Dr. King. I'm Bernard Lee.
Well, I was Don't in Air Force that. Uniform last time you saw me. I came in late for the sermon. We talked for a while. I'll stay here in case anything happens.
I don't need a bodyguard.
You need something else. I sit in a rock on my porch with a rifle in my hand. And anybody come near the house, they know what to expect.
What's the matter, Mom?
Nothing. Could have killed you and Yogi. Trying so hard not to hate. Trying to remember it isn't all of them. I'm not here to take you up here and go and stay with my father. I want to apply for a license for a gun.
Whole town's upset. Them bombing your house. They bombed Reverend Pritchard's house, too. And last night, a man was killed. Got on the bus. He was all upset about the boycott. He told the bus driver he wasn't going in the back. Demanded his dime back. Cop got on. There was a fight. And they shot him. There's a group of men who think the only way that we'll solve things is with guns. They're coming here.
Coming here?
They think you'll lead them.
How can I lead them? They know my stand on nonviolence.
They think even you must know now that nonviolence doesn't work.
They have their gun, and we have ours.
You want a gun?
Here. Take this one. It's mine. Take it. I don't want it. Take it! Take it!
Here,
you arrested Ralph.
Even the segregationists couldn't be that stupid.
What do you mean? This'll hit the front pages of every city in the country.
Well, they say they're gonna have warrants out for all of the meetings. Well, maybe we can help them get those warrants out more quickly. The movement'll certainly benefit from that publicity.
I'm afraid you don't know Southern jails. Our blacks have been known to go into them and just disappear. Now, it may be good publicity, but don't think it's not dangerous.
Yeah,
Martin?
Where are you going?
I'm going inside.
We ain't allowing no one in.
I'm going in.
You can't go in.
What's that King fella?
Get out of here.
I'm going in.
Boy, if you don't get the hell out of here, you're gonna need a lawyer. Boy, you've done it now. Let's go.
Martin!
Don't say anything.
Mark! 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 Please, Sam!
I find you guilty and fine you $10 plus costs.
I'm not going to pay it.
You're not going to pay it?
No, I am not going to pay it. I didn't do anything. I'm not going to pay a fine for an act I didn't commit, nor for the brutal treatment I didn't deserve.
Take him back to his cell.
Hanley, I ask you not to pay bail.
I didn't put up bail.
Well, who did?
I have a feeling that the police arranged it. I think they're afraid because of public opinion. You'd be more dangerous in jail than out of jail.
You know, Thoreau said it.
What?
Well, he was talking about the slavery of his time, but he said if there were 10 honest men, even if there was one honest man, who ceased to hold slaves and allowed himself to be locked up in jail, why, it'd be the abolition of slavery in America.
There were a series of arrests for minor and often imaginary traffic violations. People who'd never received a ticket were booked and taken to jail.
You're under arrest for speeding 30 miles an hour, 25-mile zone.
Keep moving.
We're waiting for the carpool.
We have a law here against loitering.
Unprecedented. I can tell you this, sir. Every objection that I've had, every objection that I've asked you, raised to my client over here, the treatment of this man...
The boycott had lasted nearly a year. The city and bus company were bleeding leaders of the boycott emotionally and economically by one court action after another. They had declared the carpools illegal. Now they were claiming that the boycotters had caused the bus company undue damage and that they had to repay $15,000.
I don't care what you say or what prosecutor
you're going far out of line with any lawyer who tries a case in this court.
I know.
You're going to get fair treatment, but you are not going to abuse this court.
I know what the legal court says. Every single thing I've done with my client over here, this is unprecedented. Every single...
Your Honor, the gentleman from the Associated Press has just handed us something which I think has a direct bearing on the case. The United States Supreme Court today affirmed a decision of a special three-judge United States District Court in declaring Alabama's state and local laws requiring segregation on buses unconstitutional.
You're Dr. King, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Well, we're glad to have you this morning.
Thank you.
When Martin boarded that bus, the first integrated bus, he felt as though he were Columbus discovering America. It seemed to him then that anything was possible.
Comic books about you now. You were the first national black hero since Frederick Douglass.
Well, heroes come and go, but this time next year, nobody remember who I am.
Stanley and I are working out the logistics to gather all the national Negro movements, with the exception of the NAACP, of course, under your leadership.
I'm not equipped to lead that kind of movement.
What are you afraid of?
I'm afraid of my own shortcomings. I'm also afraid that people don't expect me to pull rabbits out of the hat.
Don't worry, we'll tell you what to do.
If I'm going to be a leader, it's because I am the leader and no one else, Damon.
No one chooses a leader. People do. You might have wanted something else. We might have wanted to choose someone else. But it's what happened.
Stanley, I'm a pastor first and a leader second, if at all. I'll go anywhere you want and speak. I'll write about my experiences.
But I wish you could. People think that revolutions start with an injustice. They don't. They begin with hope. There are bus boycotts now in Jacksonville, Nashville, Greensboro. There's even one in Johannesburg, South Africa. Something has started. And you may be the only one to make the rest of it happen.
The knife was touching the aorta. We had to remove two ribs in order to get the knife free.
Is he all right?
Yes, unless complications set in. It is so delicate. So if he would have sneezed, he would have died.
For a moment.
Don't let him speak too much.
He's been calling for you all night.
I want to thank you all for the kind letters, wonderful flowers that you sent me while I was ill. As you know, Mrs. King and I recently went to India. Now, we may go to other places as tourists, but we went to India because of Mahatma Gandhi as pilgrims. See, Gandhi teaches us that violence does not overcome evil. It may suppress it for a time, but only to arise later with redoubled vigor. But nonviolence, on the other hand, seeks to put an end to evil by converting the evildoer. Well, while we were there, we met Nehru. And Nehru said that one of Gandhi's last public statements was to a group of visiting American blacks. He said there was no dishonor in being a slave. There was dishonor in being a slave owner. Nehru said something else. He said that Gandhi said something most curious. He said that it may be through the American Negro
the unadulterated message of nonviolence is delivered to the world. Well, a leader is needed. I doubt that I am that person. I have the greatest doubts. I must reorganize my life, reorient my personality. I've been being unfair to you. You need a full-time pastor, Mrs. Colson. You need somebody from the church to come see you when you're not feeling well. You need someone to go into those prisons when your children are in trouble. You know, we all need somebody to talk to when our marriages aren't going the way they should. Being here has been the happiest time of my life. I submit my resignation as pastor of the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church to become effective on the fourth Sunday of January.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds.
Built-in barbecue in the back.
bourgeoisie. Always ripping off black people, charging them all those fat fees for doctor bills, for food bills, and for mortgages.
Oh, of course they all mine, but we've got to have a house.
Not in Collier Heights, we don't. I don't want it.
What do you think of it, Bernard?
Well,
you think we can find some ways to improve this place?
The only way we can improve this place is the dynamite.
Dora, darling, what do you think?
Martin, it would take as much to improve this place as it would to live someplace decent.
Well, I like it. It's only 2 blocks from the church. I bought it. It was a steal.
You know what Carr's department store is like. It's practically an institution in Atlanta. If we can desegregate it, then surely every other store will follow.
Well, we don't think that Dr. King should become involved in local fights.
No? Well, just what kinds of fights do you think he should become involved in? What's the matter? Does your father have too many friends here?
You speak about Gandhi. Gandhi was always in the forefront of the battle. He was always exposing himself to danger.
Don't you think my husband exposes himself to enough danger? He's gone all over the country for snake, and you know it. Whenever you get in trouble, you call on him. And then when he comes, you criticize him for taking all the publicity.
You know what happens in cars. It's the finest department store in the Southeast, and black people are degraded every time we come into it. 5 restaurants, and we have to eat in the cafeteria. I took my little nephew there to buy a suit. You know they don't let black people try on clothes for fear it'd rub against a white person's body. They measured him with a ruler. While we were there, a white woman came in with her little boy to buy a suit and some shoes. When my little nephew looked at that, I could tell it scarred him for the rest of his life.
It's King.
Louis. It's Dr. King. It is?
We'd like to be served.
We don't serve niggers here. There's a restaurant downstairs where niggers are served.
We'd like to be served in this restaurant.
I'm glad you're here. They're at it again today.
All right, you know you're trespassing on private property. I'll give you 10 seconds to leave. All right, arrest the niggers.
Now, I don't leave without Dr. King.
It's all right, Bernard. I'll be all right, Bernard. Go on.
He's broken probation for an old traffic violation. Driving in Alabama with Georgia license plates.
Now, how can they hold him without bail for that?
They've done more. They've sentenced him to 6 months hard labor on the Georgia chain gang.
6 months hard labor on the gang for what? For a traffic violation? It's not going to stick. They'll never get away with it. They will never get away with it.
Martin never forgot that ride. In that ride was all the fear that a black man could have in 1959. Because one knew that they could take you into the countryside, murder you, and leave you on the side of the road. Or make you jump from a bridge the way they had Emmett Till not long before.
This isn't the way to Reevesville.
Agree with my son about many things, but I admire his courage a great deal. All we can do is the best we can for him and try and live up to that courage.
Mommy, there's someone on the phone.
Jokey, get off the telephone.
Mrs. King.
Yes?
Senator Kennedy.
This is Senator Kennedy. I was just thinking about you and Dr. King and wanted to express to you my concern about your husband and ask if there's anything I can do.
Well, thank you. I appreciate your concern. And I would appreciate anything you can do to help.
I've spoken to the authorities in Reevesville.
Thank you.
Understand, you're expecting a baby.
Yes. Yes, I am.
Hope you don't let this disturb you too much. If there's anything I can do to help, please feel free to call.
Well, thank you. It was very kind of you to call.
You say my father was a great man. I wish I remembered him better. He was always going to jail. But the last time I would see him would be on an airplane. So I thought he went to jail on the airplane. I was fascinated by what was on the airplane.
Why can't we just freeze Jokey just as she is?
Oh. I got a satchel full of votes, and I'm going to drop them all in the lap of John F. Kennedy.
I'll be too much in a hurry to do
Come
that.
On. Kennedy's running a very tight election with Nixon. He needs that black vote. And he may not have done this out of the loftiest of motives. There are times the morally wise is also the politically expedient.
My name is Andrew Young. In 1961, the law of the land was that all interstate travel facilities must be integrated. On May 4th, blacks and whites trained in nonviolence boarded buses. We were coming into Montgomery. The police were supposed to provide protection.
Open it.
I'm John Sigenthaler. Attorney General Robert Kennedy has
hit that nigga, turn it inside out! Come here, Robert! Come on, you leave us alone! Leave us alone!
I don't have the power to stop them. I'm not even sure I would want to.
Let's put this in perspective. You have a friend in this administration.
We're not so sure of that.
Could you explain that, please?
There was a plank in your platform that pledged sweeping and historical fight for integration. You pledged that you would wipe out housing discrimination with a stroke of the pen.
We've appointed Negroes to some very significant jobs.
Yes, and you've appointed three of the most outspoken segregationists to the first three federal judgeships.
You may have noticed, I didn't win this election for the greatest of mandates. The extent of what I can do is somewhat limited.
You can take the mandate. You're president of the United States. You can do anything you want to do.
There are other things I want to accomplish in this administration, Mr. Harrison.
There's nothing more important in this issue. It's the central moral issue in the United States, and you know it.
But civil rights isn't very good politics, is it?
It's lousy politics.
I've been in this office many times, and I've talked with many men sitting in that chair. The best of them was Roosevelt, and I had to threaten him with a mass march on the Capitol before he would issue decrees prohibiting job discrimination in the war industries on the basis of color. Just so he would do
that. Yes, yes, that's all very well, but you see, I am the Attorney General of the United States. And right now, at this very moment, there is a group of your freedom riders in a church in Montgomery, surrounded by a mob that wants to kill them. Now, how am I going to get them out of there?
Let them kill them. Let them kill them. Churches have been bombed. A minister's been beaten to death because he wanted to give support to black people. Children have been on the verge of starvation. What do you give a damn about those people in that church for? Because of some newspaper stories have been written about them?
Yes, well, why don't you get proof for me and then we can prosecute? But we can't prosecute without proof.
The FBI gets proof every day of beatings, rapes, and yes, murders. But those reports are suppressed or destroyed. And there's been one single conviction. But you won't do anything about that, will you? And I'll tell you why. Because you don't want to have a confrontation with J. Edgar Hoover, do you?
How'd it go?
The new frontier is not nearly new enough. And the frontier is set too close to the rear.
Where are you going?
Going to Montgomery.
And people think he wasn't scared. I know better.
What's the matter? I got the hiccup. Excuse me, can you give me a glass of water, please?
Yes, we keep hearing that morals can't be legislated. But behavior can be legislated. The law may not be able to make a man love me, but it can certainly stop him from lynching me.
Yeah.
safety of every person in that church.
We're doing everything we can, but the general can't guarantee the safety of Martin Luther King.
Well, would you put him on, please? I'd like to hear him say that to me. I'd like to hear a general in the United States Army tell me that he can't protect Martin Luther King.
He didn't say it. I said it.
I see. You said it. I want every federal marshal in Alabama in Montgomery.
What have you done here?
Don't you like it?
What's happened to it?
I've been working so hard on it.
I don't need this. I picked this place. I was in the poorest neighborhood near the church.
I just wanted someplace nice for you to come back to after all those terrible things you go through.
I don't want it. You and the children can live here, but I don't want it.
Now you just listen to me. We are going to have a real home for the first time in our lives. Yes. And we are going to have drapes and slipcovers. And we're going to have dinner together. You and me and the children. Just us. And we're not going to talk about all the terrible things that happened to you on the road or in jail, all the battles ahead. And this is going to be someplace that you can come back to and look forward to. And it'll always be here. And get your shoes off the bed.
Here's another chapter in my book. I never make that decision.
They found Goodman, Cheney, and Swerner.
Where?
Buried in a dam in Mississippi.
Are, they were picked up by the sheriff's office and they were released in the middle of the night and then they disappeared, never to be seen again until now.
Their movements were known by the sheriff's office. It must have been someone in that sheriff's office.
I wonder how some of our brave young people who are saying that white shouldn't be part of this movement are feeling now. Who did it?
Half the men in Philadelphia, Mississippi, go around bragging they were the ones that put the bullets in the Goodman.
But we're going to Philadelphia, Mississippi.
Are you serious?
Two white men. Might be good public relations. How dangerous is it?
They'll kill them. They'll tear them apart.
I'll contact the FBI. Tell them we're coming down there. We'll need protection.
What do you think the FBI consists of in Philadelphia, Mississippi? Mississippi boys. They probably have lunch and dinner with the murderers. They're members of the community. They don't want to rock the boat. The only people relevant to them are local white people.
We have that meeting in Washington. It's important.
No. Nothing is more important than going to Philadelphia, Mississippi. Nothing.
I wish every racist, white and otherwise, could be here today to say thank you to three boys who died. two whites and one black who believed in equality for everybody.
I think it's time for a prayer.
Whenever we're in trouble, you always call on me for a prayer.
Make it a quick one.
You don't mind if I keep my eyes open, do you?
Dr. Abernathy will now deliver a prayer.
Look down upon us, O Lord. Forgive us, sinners, for we must all be forgiven. Who knows, perhaps the murderers of Goodman, Sherman, and Cheney are near us at this moment.
You're damn right. They're right behind you.
Amen.
Let's go.
I want to talk to you.
Don't pay no attention to that trash.
All right. If they want me, they can take me.
Yeah, I'm here. Now, what do you want to do?
Come on.
Well,
I'm here.
Come on.
I'm Dr. King. What do you want?
Come on.
Give us a note.
Come on,
say what you have to say.
Come on. There are beatings, rapes, and murders taking place in the South every day, and they're being reported to the FBI. The problem is, in my opinion, that too many agents in the FBI in the southern states share the same racist attitudes as the law enforcement officials
there.
You just stay right there.
Stay right there.
They are more interested in keeping their relationship with the local police,
Martin,
and the people who are promoting segregation than they are in seeing
Martin,
that people
you cannot
are protected.
Give that interview. You don't know how sensitive Hoover is to criticism
to
about the FBI.
To keep their status, they must be friendly with the local police and the people who are promoting segregation.
Martin, you cannot fight with Hoover. Presidents are afraid to do it.
In my opinion, the FBI has been most efficient as an agency for the solution of ordinary crimes, and perhaps it should just stick to that.
Martin Luther King is the most notorious liar in the United States. I have been handed a note telling me I should keep these statements concerning King off the record. But that's none of his business. I made it for the record. And you can use it for the record. Have you taken it down, word for word? Martin Luther King is the most notorious liar in the United States.
There's a medium invented called television that captures faces. I'd like the rest of the country to see what we've seen all our lives. Yes, television is going to be the medium in which we're going to bring this country face to face with itself.
M.L. King Jr.
Martin Luther King Jr., a brilliant young man studying for the ministry, falls in love with Coretta Scott, a music student at Boston University. Coretta is attracted to him, but wonders why he wishes to become a minister.
To really follow the precepts of Jesus would probably be the most dangerous, most revolutionary thing in the world.
Are you going to try it?
Me, I'm just a middle-class preacher, son.
Coretta and King marry, and he becomes a minister in Montgomery. Rosa Parks refuses to get up and give her seat to a white person on a bus in Montgomery.
Why do you stand up?
Do you think it's right that I should have to stand up after I got on the bus and took a seat?
I don't know, but the law is the law, and you're under arrest.
You don't know how sensitive Hoover is to critics of the FBI.
To keep their status, they must be friendly with the local police and the people who are promoting segregation.
Martin, you cannot fight with Hoover. Presidents are afraid to do it.
Martin Luther King is the most notorious liar in the United States. Have you taken it down, word for word? Martin Luther King is the most notorious liar in the United States.
A city this side of Johannesburg, South Africa.
And that's why we're here.
There he is. Will Connor.
Nobody looks like that. They must have made him up.
Will Connor is Birmingham.
Who is he?
He was a sports announcer. He's very popular. And he got it in his mind that he wanted to go into politics. Now he's commissioner for public safety.
I know Mr. Connor from way back. He was a first-class strike breaker.
Still thinking you can desegregate this place non-violently, Martin?
If Birmingham is the most powerful city in the South, if we can desegregate it non-violently, we can desegregate the South.
There's a medium invented called television that captures faces. I'd like the rest of the country to see what we've seen all our lives. This television is going to be the medium in which we're going to bring this country face to face with itself.
Hello, Dr. King.
Hello. My brother, A.D., do you know where he is?
He's in the office.
Thank you.
Don't you gonna meet me at the airport, Eddie? What happened? I want you to give one of your special introductions tonight, all right? Now, don't make it too long. Last time we just went on and on. About 8 minutes would be about right.
I can't do it. I can't do it. I ain't up to it.
What do you mean you're not up to it? You're a wonderful speaker. You're lovable. That's what you are. You're lovable. And you know why? Because you make people feel important.
They're asking me to resign.
Nobody's going to ask you to resign because you're going to be brilliant tonight.
Martin Luther King has become a famous man. But to me, he's still my brother Mike. I opened one of the letters that came to our house today, and it said, "This is not a threat, but a promise. Your head will be blown off." But Mike got a hard head. I remember a time when Mike was leaning against an upstairs banister. He plunged headfirst into the floor. It must have been 20 feet from the top of the banister. I said it must have been 20 feet from the top of the banister, right on his head. But nothing broken, nothing scratched. Then he was riding a bike, and a car hit the bike and hurled ML into the sidewalk. I mean, he flew over the handlebars into the ground. He flew over the handlebars into the ground. Still, all right. Then I remember a time when we were playing baseball. Now, Mike was the bat catcher, and like my bat slipped out of my hands and hit Mike on the head. Wow. I bent over Mike. I said, "Mike, are you all right?" And the first thing Mike said when he opened his eyes was, "You out, you missed on your third strike." One of the women in the congregation, and she said, "The Lord had a hand on him even then." She said, "He was saving him for us. No harm could come to him." I said, "No harm could come to him." You know, I think maybe she was right. I just think maybe she was right. Maybe he gave Mike a hard head for that purpose. My brother, Martin Luther King.
Thought that A.D. was a better preacher than I am. And tonight proves it, doesn't it? Thank you. Tonight many people, including black people, are asking, why are we in Birmingham? Why direct action? Why sit-ins, marches, and so forth? Well, my friends, I must tell you, that we have not made one single gain in civil rights without determined, legal, and nonviolent pressure. Lamentably, it is an historical fact that privileged groups seldom give up their privileges voluntarily. Like to do? Use Molotov cocktails? That is not our movement. I'll tell you what our movement is. It's to understand him. Yes, even him. It's to ask yourself what it would be like if you were taught since you were a child, since you were baby enough to crawl, that the Negro is a thing. If you had been taught by your parents By your teachers? Yes, even the preachers and the people sitting next to you in church. That it's not wrong to hate. And what would you be then? That's what this movement is. It's to reveal these people to themselves.
Shuttlesworth.
Give me a knife.
Well, you're Shuttlesworth.
Yes, sir.
Shuttlesworth, you've done more to hurt the niggers in this city, to set them back, than any man in the history of this city.
That depends on how you look at it, Mr. Connors.
You're going to find that I'm your best friend.
You're my best friend? That's a surprise.
What are you up to now?
We're going to shut down Birmingham. We're going to integrate it.
You're gonna shut down Birmingham?
Yes, sir.
Who's that?
It's Mr. Al Hibbler, famous singer from New York. Come down here to give us a hand.
Famous singer?
Yes, sir.
Shuttlesworth, I've got an injunction here from Judge Jenkins. Banning all demonstrations. I'm asking you to disband.
We can't do that.
Why not?
You're gonna shut Birmingham down.
Get the wagon. Get him in the wagon. Get them all in the wagon! Beats anything I ever saw. Hey! Bunch of yahoos.
This is going to destroy everything we've been working for.
Well, we have to go ahead?
It isn't the time.
Oh, I know. It's never the time.
If you wait a few months...
We waited long enough. We can't stop now.
Well, he won't stop. So what do we do?
Can you imagine the guts it takes to try to integrate Birmingham?
I said, what do we do?
Same thing we always do. Nothing.
Martin, gentlemen, to see you.
I'm Father Micklejohn.
Ladies. This is
Reverend Redding.
Yes.
And Reverend Jenkins. Rabbi Kaplan. Father Deans. And Reverend Hartwell.
Would you like to sit down?
I understand you're planning to use children now in your protests.
Yes, that's right.
That hardly seems brave to use children to do a man's work.
Children are very useful.
They can't be pressured to stop demonstrating because they may lose their jobs.
We want you to leave Birmingham. We can deal with our own problems.
You haven't dealt with them very well up to this time.
We're not the only ones in this community that want you to leave. There are black people in this community that want you to leave, too.
Yeah, I'll bet there are.
I can't understand you.
You're a clergyman. We're here because we are clergymen.
And how can you stand there and preach to your congregations about Jesus?
What you're doing here is illegal.
And everything that Adolf Hitler did in Germany was legal. And yet I know that if I had lived in Germany at that time, I would have aided the Jews. I would have openly advocated disobeying the law. You protest now. But why have you never protested the reasons that we're here?
Why didn't you protest when homes were bombed and people were killed? Where are your collective voices? When hatred and defiance are called for by the white people who sit in your very own churches?
Will you stop these demonstrations?
No.
If you continue, people will be hurt. People may be killed.
Yes. Perhaps.
You're a man who preaches nonviolence and prays in his heart for violence.
Put them in the fairground. But after this, I don't think we'll have it.
Keep on walking, keep on talking, marching at the Freedom Day.
Ball. I got my best side. You know, I used to be one of you guys. Had the best sports program in this city. Ah. What kind of lens is that?
New zoom lens, Ball. The guy's just for you.
Zoom lens. I heard about that. You know, I'm thinking I have my own talk show. A few laughs, a little meat on it.
It's kids this time.
It's no difference.
Freedom, 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 freedom.
What do you want?
Feed him.
You
You are in violation of city ordinance number 1169 of the city code, demonstrating and parading without a license. Now, just go back. Just go back now. Come on, go back. Go back now. Go back home. Come on now. You should all just go back. Just go back now. Go back home. Turn them on.
I can't believe my eyes.
Well, Connor may be the best ally the civil rights movement ever had.
This comes a time when a movement is judged by its leader. I can't be out of jail while old ladies and children are in.
Martin, you can't go to jail.
Where would we be if something happened to you? You're too important to the movement.
They could set up a riot. You could be killed by accident.
We run out of bail money, Martin. You're the only one who can help us raise it. If you go, all those people in jail will stay there indefinitely.
Martin?
I'm going. I don't know what's going to happen to those 300 people in jail, but there are 20 million people in this country watching us.
Buddy, I'm going to get my dungarees, too.
We shall overcome.
We shall overcome someday. Deep in my heart, and we shall overcome
God bless you, Dr. King.
Oh,
you hear anything?
Nothing. Nothing at all.
Mrs. King, this is Robert Kennedy.
Yes.
Yes, I know you tried to get in touch with the president, but he's not available right now. Is there anything I can do?
My husband is in jail in Birmingham.
Yes, I know.
I haven't heard from my husband in 3 days. I mean, he always calls me after he's arrested. Even his lawyers can't get in to see him. I don't know what happened to him.
Birmingham is a difficult place, Mrs. King, huh? We're doing everything we can. And I'll let you know as soon as I hear anything.
Thank you.
I guess what they say about Jack Kennedy is true. He made the call because of the election.
Where's your...
Oh, no, it's all right.
No, it isn't all right. You're good enough to come down here and cook us a meal, and she's on the telephone. It's getting to be a disease. Mommy, there's a woman on the phone. Hello?
Mrs. King?
Yes?
The president is on the phone.
Oh, yes.
How are you, Mrs. King? I understand you talked to my brother yesterday.
Yes.
Sorry I couldn't call you personally. I was with my father. He's ill.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
You might be interested to know that the Justice Department was called in last night. They talked to your husband. He's all right.
Oh, thank you.
We'll be keeping on top of the situation. If you get worried again, feel free to call the Attorney General or Mr. Salinger. They know where to reach me.
Thank you.
You know where to reach me now, don't you?
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so very much.
You have got to get up and get out of here. All of you! Now, come on! Come on, get up and move! Come on. Come on. Get up and get out of here now!
Lieutenant,
all of you.
Lieutenant Dunn, can I speak with you for a moment?
All of you, listen to me, move!
Lieutenant, can I just speak with you for one moment, please?
We cannot allow demonstrations.
Lieutenant, this is Easter Sunday. Nearly every leader of our movement is in jail.
Now, come on, all of you, get out
of
the jail, move out!
In front of it and say a few prayers, just an Easter Sunday meeting.
I can't allow you to do that.
Why?
Because it's against the law.
If you really want to enforce the law, move your men back 2 blocks and give us half an hour.
But if you want to beat me, if you want to beat up children, just like your own kids, go ahead. It's your choice.
What's going on here? What's going on here?
Hey, just want to go over by the jail and pray.
Disperse! Disperse!
Few hundred people. He had raised an army of thousands.
He had filled the jails the way Gandhi had in India. The department stores were empty. The effectiveness of the work in the steel plants was sharply curtailed because of the division among the men. Martin Luther King had desegregated the toughest town in the South. But Birmingham wasn't the end. Hundreds, then thousands of other cities in the South desegregated because of Birmingham. Birmingham became the Bunker Hill of the movement.
The idea is to consolidate our gains.
Hey, Philip Randolph's been talking to me about a march.
March on Washington. March is on Washington, I don't
know. Not on the field we've been talking about.
No. The idea is...
What's the professor
on the side? Hi, Fred, how
are you? I have many people. Was anybody hurt? Oh. Well, yes. Of course, I'll come. Yes. Yeah. You know, find out what time the next plane leaves Birmingham. They bombed Reverend Cross's church. They killed four children. They were sitting in Sunday school. What are we doing? Huh? Is it worth it? Is anything worth it? Am I a monster?
We see before us a great triumph for segregation. The murder of four little girls while they were studying at Sunday school. It was a terrible deed. But perhaps less terrible than the response of this community. I suppose it was too much to ask that it be officially said that the murder of children is wrong. I suppose it was too much to expect that one white official might attend the ceremonies so that the parents might feel better. As a matter of fact, I don't see one white face here except for white ministers. And I still believe in nonviolence. Consider this a down payment on freedom. History has proved again and again that unmerited suffering is redemptive. And perhaps the innocent blood of these little girls might prove to be the
redemptive force to bring the light. Miss Doss.
David, I will speak on television tomorrow night.
I want to go on record. If you make this speech, your chances of being re-elected are nil. I know you were moved by King's speech.
Somebody has to use the moral power of this office to say that segregation is wrong. Is that such a brave thing to do?
Yes. There have been some brave men in that chair.
but they've all been very clever and very careful how they reacted in regard to this issue.
Maybe that's the trouble. Maybe we've all been too clever.
It ought to be possible for American students of any color to attend any public institutions without having to be backed up by troops. And it ought to be possible for American citizens of any color to register, to vote in a free election without fear of reprisal. But such is not the case. We say to the world and to each other that this is the land of the free. Does it mean that it is the land of the free, except for the Negroes? That we have no master race, except with respect to Negroes? Confronted primarily with a moral issue. It is as old as the scriptures and as clear as the American Constitution. The heart of the question is whether all Americans are to be afforded equal rights and equal opportunities. Those who do nothing are inviting shame as well as violence. Those who act boldly are recognizing right as well as reality. Next week, I will ask Congress to make the commitment it has not yet fully made in this century. The commitment to the proposition that race has no place in American life or law.
J. Edgar Hoover was one of the greatest investigators and administrators this country has ever known. But he was 68 years old. His knowledge of blacks came from the area around Washington when blacks were allowed to be nothing more than janitors and chauffeurs. He felt that they should be restricted to that. He asked me to make the most intensive investigation in the Bureau's history about the influence of communists on the civil rights movement and on Dr. King. I knew he wasn't going to like my conclusions.
There has been an obvious failure of the Communist Party of the United States appreciably infiltrate, influence, or control large numbers of American Negroes in this community. Dr. King?
There's no reason to suspect him being a communist or a communist sympathizer.
This memo reminds me vividly of those I received when Castro took over Cuba. Contended then that Castro and his cohorts were not communists and were not influenced by communists. Time proved you wrong.
Yes. Mr. Hoover, I can only report my findings to you as honestly as I can. I spent a good many months working on that report, you know.
I know you have.
Yes, I did that.
I know you've taken time for us that you could have been doing other things. That's why it's all the more a disappointment.
Well, I can't help it if those are the conclusions that I honestly reached. I said that, I said that time alone would tell. And over here, I said that they're making prodigious efforts to infiltrate them. I said that.
Why are you qualifying this for? Major report.
Good morning.
He didn't speak to me for months. To be in trouble with Hoover was a serious matter. He was capable of firing a whole department. We all had mortgages on homes, children in school, etc.
Take down this memo.
We regret greatly that the memo did not live up to what the director has a right to expect from us, from our analysis. But now,
stressing the urgent need for imaginative and aggressive tactics to be utilized through our counterintelligence program to attempt to neutralize or disrupt the party's activities in the Negro field. We must mark King
now,
if we have not already done so, as a most dangerous Negro to the future of this nation. From the standpoint of communism, the Negro, and national security.
I can't understand how you can so agilely switch your thinking. Now you want to load down the field with more coverage, in spite of your past evaluation. I don't intend to waste time and money until you can make up your minds what the situation really is.
What does he want with us?
What does he want? You know what he wants, don't you? He wants us to tell him he was mild in his assessment of the influence of communists on King and the movements, even though there's no evidence there's any. He wants us to out Hoover Hoover. Find out if there's any possibility of using Mrs. King. Find out if there are any disgruntled employees. Find out about all the financial dealings of King and what we can exploit to our advantage. Give me the files on King's age, will you? Can't find anything on King. Maybe we can find something on them. That's what Hoover wants. People later asked me whether I thought what we were doing was illegal, unethical, or immoral. The matter of legality, morals, or ethics was never raised by myself or anyone else.
Why did you cry with your father today, Marty?
They tease me because of him. They say, your father's a jailbird.
Do you know why he goes to jail? He goes to jail to help people. Do you remember when you wanted to go to Funtown? Remember how you felt when we told you you couldn't go because you were black? Your father couldn't sleep all night. He had to go to Birmingham the next day, and he said, tell him that it isn't because he's not as good as anybody else. Tell him that he'll be able to go someday. So you gotta help him, Marty, because he doesn't like going to jail. He's as frightened of it as anybody else, and he's alone. He's very much alone.
I want to thank you for what was said. It had never been said before.
Thank you, but I'm concerned about this march. We want a civil rights bill, not a television spectacular. Supposing there's an incident.
There won't be an incident.
I know those fellas on the Hill. I spent a good many years with them. Now, you don't want them to say, yes, I am for the bill, but I'll be damned if I'll vote for it at the point of a gun.
If they don't want to vote for it, they'll find a reason not to, won't they?
It isn't the time.
You know, I've never been engaged in any direct action movement that didn't seem ill-timed. Mm-hmm. Some people thought that Birmingham was ill-timed.
Including the Attorney General.
Yes.
If you want to hold the march, there's nothing we can do to stop you. Robert wants to talk to you about something.
Certainly.
Would you mind, Mr. Vice President?
Dr. King?
We'd like to talk to you about an advisor of yours.
What advisor?
Stanley Levison.
What about Stanley?
Hoover says he's a communist.
You know, I thought we'd gone beyond that in this country.
McCarthy's dead, but the melody lingers on.
I've looked at the files. There's enough ammunition there.
What sort of ammunition?
People have said things about him. There are statements that he's made.
People have said things about you, too. The statements you've made. Would you like to be held accountable for everything you've said?
I'm a pragmatist. I'm telling you these things can be used, and they can be used effectively. Now, you have to dismiss Levison.
It isn't as easy as that. He's a valuable man to the movement. And in addition, he is a friend of mine.
The Southern strategy is going to be to say that the civil rights movement is riddled with communists. I've got a civil rights bill I want to pass. We can't take a chance of anything hurting that, can we?
There's no choice. I have to go.
You've had to work in the shadows because there are races and whole people who don't like the idea of a white man contributing too much. Stanley, I owe you so much. Remember when you tried to frame me on Texas? You said it isn't up to you to defend yourself. It's up to us to defend you. It'll be you against the state of Alabama, but the people will believe you.
Oh, it doesn't matter now. Does it? Nothing must be allowed to hurt the movement.
I wonder whether it's worth it. I wonder whether, in spite of it all, I shouldn't just call Hoover on this thing and see it out all the way to the end.
You tried that once. He gets a better press than you. Inspiring experience of my life.
Stanley's leaving the movement.
I talked to the Attorney General's office. He has no evidence. It's a downright lie. Stanley's not a communist, never has been.
We need that bill. We can't take a chance on anything hurting.
We need that bill, but I wonder, is anything worth doing this to Stanley?
Washington is a city of spectacle. Every 4 years, there are imposing presidential inaugurations. But in its entire history, Washington had never seen a spectacle the size and grandeur that assembled there on August 28, 1963. 250,000 people journeyed that day to the Capitol. They came from almost every state in the Union. They came in every form of transportation. They were an army without guns, but not without strength.
I say to you today, my friends, that even though we face difficulties today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day, on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of oppression, sweltering with the heat of injustice, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. When we let freedom ring, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing the words of that old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty,
come back.
I didn't bring that living room into a handball court again.
Corey, we don't have no place else to play. Now, we're not going to break none of your things. All right, Joe Sam, go ahead. It's all right, Yogi.
Oh!
Nothing fell, it just stumbled a little bit, that's all.
Martin, would you come here a minute, please?
The streets are the police station, and it's practically impossible to find out exactly what's happening.
Here is a flash from Dallas. Two priests who were with President Kennedy say he is dead of bullet wounds suffered in the assassination attempt today. I repeat, with the greatest regret, this flash. Two priests who were with President Kennedy say he has died of bullet wounds.
The events of the day seem almost more bizarre in retrospect. Just this morning, the president seemed so relaxed. The apprehensions he had had before about the Texas trip were gone. The crowd seemed friendly, receptive. Whatever reservations the people of Texas had about Kennedy seemed to have been overcome.
This is the way I'm going to go.
Why, what are you talking about?
The sickness in this country, Cor. It's deeper than I ever knew. I'm going to reach my 40th birthday.
Dr. King, I am delighted to see you.
Well, thank you, Mr. President.
Won't you sit down?
Thank you.
You know, I've had every public leader worth anything in this room in the last 10 days. Meany, Rockefeller, Henry Ford. Oh, but this is a moment that I've been waiting for. You know, there's been a great deal of rhetoric about civil rights spoken here in the last few years.
There's been a little more than rhetoric.
Of course. But it is a long way from rhetoric to action. You and I are going to do some great things together. And I am going to get particular satisfaction out of it. Because it is going to be accomplished by a Southerner.
Hello?
Hello, is this Mrs. King?
Yes.
This is Ned Ramsey from the Associated Press.
We've just received word from Norway that your husband has been given the Nobel Peace Prize for 1964. Is it possible for us to talk to Dr. King?
Well, he's in hospital right now.
I hope nothing's wrong.
Just fatigue, that's all.
You must be very proud of him.
Well, yes, I am.
Can I call back for a comment?
Yes, of course. How's the Nobel Peace Prize winner for 1964 feeling this morning? Martin, did you hear what I said? You have won the Nobel Peace Prize. Martin? What?
Did you just call me?
Yes, I did.
I thought I was dreaming. But are you sure it's not a hoax?
No, it's not a hoax, Martin. Do you know what it says? It says that they're wrong and you're right, Martin. That's what it says.
Why didn't you check with me before you sent this out?
I didn't see the necessity of checking with you.
Well, will you tell me why it was necessary to send these to generals in the army? To Adlai Stevenson, to Vice President Humphrey, to Rockefeller, to President Johnson, and to Bill Moyers?
It was my judgment that they needed to have it.
Needed to have it! They needed to have this character assassination, this compendium of scurrilous gossip and hearsay? Why?
It's good for them to know who they're dealing with when the crisis comes.
Yes, what crisis?
The Black Insurrection.
Mr. Hoover. Mr. Hoover, I know that you've done a great deal of service for this country, but I think that for any man to have as much power for as long as you have is not only wrong, but it's dangerous. It's terribly dangerous. Now, I want back every copy of this so-called monograph.
It's already gone out.
I am ordering you to get them back! And I believe I'm your superior.
No attorney general has ever said that to me before. No president has ever said that before. I appreciate the high moral tone of your tenure, Mr. Kennedy. Except that you authorized wiretaps on your friend, Dr. King, yourself. I have it in your own handwriting.
Yes. Yes, I did. And I was wrong to have authorized them. I thought that my brother was getting mixed up with Dr. King in the public mind. I thought that if Dr. King were discredited, then my brother would be discredited. But my brother is no longer alive, Mr. Hoover. And I have nothing to protect now. So besides getting back every copy of these monographs, I want a letter from each of the people stating that they never read it. And I want it in writing. Is that clear?
I would like to make a toast to God.
Oh, don't you think that's a little pretentious, Ben?
My father was a sharecropper, and I wasn't able to finish college till I was a grown man with a wife and three children. And I prayed to God
that he would let my children do the things that I couldn't do. And he has answered my prayer. In some kind of way, I don't even know how, he come down through Georgia and laid his hands on me and my wife and gave us Martin Luther King. And now, the King family will go down not only in American history, but in the history of the world as well, because Martin Luther King is a Nobel Prize winner.
I want to tell a story about myself. One that I'm ashamed of. It's about, I believe it was the first time Martin spoke publicly. It was for a high school debate. Martin worked so hard for it. He spoke so well. Everyone attending was so sure he'd won. For the other boy was white. Martin was black. Of course, the white boy won. I never saw Martin so disappointed. So when he got home, I said, Martin, you're a little Negro boy. You're not going to change this world. I was trying to save him what I thought could be heartbreak. I was so afraid for him. I almost did what millions of black mothers do all the time. Our sons less. But one man can make a difference. And that's why we're here tonight.
Modern man has built gigantic bridges to span the seas and gargantuan buildings to kiss the skies. And yet, in spite of these spectacular strides in science and technology and still unlimited ones to come, there is a poverty of a spirit which stands in glaring contrast to our scientific and technological abundance. We have learned to fly the air like birds and swim the sea like fish, but we have not learned the simple art of living together as brothers.
Wait a minute!
What are you doing? Don't hit him! Don't hit him!
You're not going to stop us from our constitutional right to vote.
I've been looking down the line and I see people here have been in jail on felonies. That's what I'm looking at.
Many of those who have felony actions against them. Many of those who have felony actions against them, they have them because Sheriff Carruthers made them felony actions, not because they were rightfully arrested.
Ah, wait, you don't have to beat him. Wait a minute.
What are you doing? Don't hit him. Don't hit him.
You don't have to beat him.
On your
arrest
feet.
Us. We come here to register the vote. Arrest us if we're wrong. Arrest us if we're wrong. We have a right to register to vote. I graduated from a university in the state.
We want to register. And then have lunch before
the... Uniforms! Pour me a minute!
Leave him alone.
Are you all right?
I got a hard head.
No registration today.
Why not?
There are no registrars working today.
Well, I would like to go in and see if the registrar is in the election office.
Take my word for it. Nobody in there.
We'll be back.
Some of these people here have been arrested for felonies.
Every person here is a citizen who has contributed to this community and has led a decent life and deserves the right to exercise his constitutional privilege. We're going to stop you from using that club in the shadows and make you do it in the glaring light of television.
There's no registration today.
I can't promise you that you won't get beaten. I can't promise you that your homes won't be bombed, but I can promise you that we'll be back. If they won't let us register, we'll go to George Wallace. And if he doesn't listen, we'll appeal to the legislature. And the legislature doesn't listen, we'll dramatize the situation by marching by the thousands to places of registration. I'll go to the president. And if need be, we'll go to jail by the thousands. We need a voting rights bill.
But we just passed a civil rights bill. Now you're going too fast.
People have a constitutional right to vote.
But Congress isn't ready for it yet.
And we'll have to make them ready for it. We're planning a march from Selma to Montgomery.
All right. I can't tell you this officially, of course, but march.
We'll need you to send in federal troops.
No, not yet.
You know what happened on the bridge.
Not yet. If we call out the troops now, it'll just make a martyr out of George Wallace.
Those are 50 of the most dangerous miles in this country for a black man to march.
If you want to... voting rights bill, you're going to need pressure. A lot of pressure. Something big. Something spectacular. Something like Birmingham.
People died in Birmingham.
What about security?
I've taken care of it.
I want to see them. We've got to be sure that there are no snipers on the roof.
We can get a clear view of those roofs in the alley. Right? Okay.
We march in the morning. Is Johnson sending in troops?
I don't know.
You don't know? Anything can happen in any one of those 54 miles.
Andy, there's nothing we can do.
There's something you can do. Jimmy Lee Jackson's gone. Medgar Evers, Kennedy, Tom Moore. Now we've got the tip that the Klan has hired someone to kill you. But it isn't just the Klan. You think the Nobel Prize has helped? It's made it worse. You're the biggest target in this country.
Hello, Damon.
Well, Judge Johnson has given you permission to march. Two abreast, and only 50 of you.
Why? That's suicide.
Why? Guarantee traffic safety. All right. We will march, only 50 of us, and two abreast. We will march from here to the steps of the cradle of the Confederacy to ensure that everybody has a right to vote. Now, Damon, get me Archbishop Icarus. Get me Walter Luther. Get me Bishop Millard. Get me every member of the SCLC and anybody else you can think of. They won't be able to march with us on the highway. They can march with us to it. And anybody else who wants to join us in Montgomery later when we get there.
If we get there. What? Oh.
Greta, what are you doing here?
I'm going to march.
No, you cannot go on this march.
Oh, yes, I can. You're not going to keep me in the house this time. Not this time.
But what about the kids?
The children are all right. I left them with Mom and Dad.
I guess there's just no stopping you, is there?
Not this time. You look so tired.
smoke in front of anybody else. Julian Bond told me he was as shocked to see me smoking as if it was his own mother. I'm not a saint. I wish I were.
What's the matter?
March. Oh, Corey. Girl, this is the most dangerous march we've ever been on. I know that somebody is going to die on these 54 miles. Why is it that we need a human sacrifice for every gain that we make?
Now, it's a dangerous march, Martin, but it's the most important one. It's 102 years since the Emancipation Proclamation. And yet college graduates in Selma, Alabama can't vote. Didn't you say that one day we would have a say in who's president of these United States? Give us the ballot, you said, and we will change the history of this country.
I know, Corey, but isn't there some other way?
Ramsey Clark. I was Deputy Attorney General of the United States. My job was to watch over the march from Selma to Montgomery. It was a dangerous situation. You could feel the poison of the country drawn to that area. Violent racists had drifted toward the scene from hundreds of miles around. We knew murder could strike from any window or rooftop, from around any corner of any building or alleyway. You had to guard against a potential assassin in every pickup truck that drove by, around every farmhouse or country store, every clump of trees or bend in the road.
And put it up.
There's Tony Bennett. He's here for that Nigger King. He's my favorite singer, too.
Just in time, I found you just in time. Before you came, my time was running low. I was lost, the losing dice were tossed. My bridges all were crossed, nowhere to go. Well, now you're here, now I know just where I'm going. No more doubt.
I can't tell you how weird that was, singing in the dark, not knowing what was out there. I looked out to see what I could see on that platform, and there was just his face looking at me, smiling as though we were on a Sunday school picnic, and out there were thousands of people just waiting to kill him if they could. And I concentrated on that face and sang to him.
No more doubt or fear, I found my way. 'Cause love came just in time. I found you just in time. Then you changed my lonely life. That lovely day, you changed my lonely life. That lovely day.
I want to thank Mr. Bennett, Mr. Belafonte, and all the other wonderful entertainers who've come down here to help us. I wonder if they know how much it means to us and how much we appreciate it.
I appreciate it. I've sung before royalty and movie stars and the White House since, but nothing ever meant as much to me as he sang that.
Is to dry.
Every little bit helps.
I'll see you later. See ya. What's your name?
Ellie.
Oh, hey, Ellie! Oh. Ellie, I forgot the mustard.
Oh, thank you very much.
You a student?
In a way. I want to be. I want to attend barber school over in Mobile.
Barber school.
And you you tired? You want me to drive?
No, I'll be all right. That must be crazy.
You got some place to stay in Selma?
No, I was gonna make one more trip back. Unless I'm killed in the meantime.
I think you hit him.
Baby brother, I don't miss.
It was Jackson on the roads of Alabama. It was Reeve on the roads of Alabama. William Moore's dead and gone.
Hey! Help!
Now Leo's on the roads of Alabama.
Help!
King goes to Birmingham. He uses nonviolent protest in an attempt to desegregate the largest industrial city of the South. He uses black citizens of the town, including children.
This comes a time when a movement is judged by its leader. I can't be out of jail while old ladies and children are in.
King himself decides to go to jail, in spite of the fact that there is danger that he will be killed in prison. The protest is continued until Bull Connor, the Commissioner of Public Safety, can no longer make the guards and police turn the hoses on the protesters. The back of the Birmingham authorities is broken.
Turn on the hose! Turn on the hose! Turn on! Turn on the hose!
Martin Luther King had come to Birmingham with a few hundred people. He'd raised an army of thousands. He had filled the jails the way Gandhi had in India. Martin Luther King had desegregated the toughest town in the South. Attorney General Robert Kennedy finds out that J. Edgar Hoover has sent out a dossier of rumors, slander, and innuendo about King. Kennedy protests it's being sent out without his consent.
Mr. Hoover, I know that you've done a great deal of service for this country, but I think that for any man to have as much power for as long as you have is not only wrong, but it's dangerous. It's terribly dangerous. Now, I want back every copy of this so-called monograph.
It's already gone out.
I am ordering you to get them back! And I believe I'm your superior!
No attorney general has ever said that to me before. No president has ever said that before.
King takes his followers on the most dangerous march of their existence, from Selma to Montgomery, the cradle of the Confederacy, to dramatize the right of every citizen to vote. There is danger in every one of the 54 miles. Viola Liuzzo, a Detroit housewife, transports students to be in Montgomery for the arrival of the marchers the next day. A car pulls up alongside hers.
Last Sunday, 8,000 of us started on a mighty walk from Selma, Alabama.
All right.
They said we wouldn't get here. There were those who said that we would get here only over their dead bodies.
All right.
Yet today all the world knows that we are here.
Yes.
And we are standing before the forces of power in the state of Alabama, right, saying we ain't about to turn around.
Now for part three of King.
Thinking about taking one of them positions they've been offering me.
Could you?
I don't know why I couldn't take off a couple of years anyway.
Do you think you could leave the movement for that long?
Oh, sure. I mean, there's Andy. He's come along fine, and Ralph, of course. You know what I was really thinking about? You know, I've never been home when our last three babies were born. Unless I do something, I'm gonna miss that childhood. I'm gonna miss it forever. Put that thing out of my face. Now,
Bernard, put it on money, the birthday girl. Now, go home.
He gonna break that camera. That costs too much money. Go on, take it. It's her party. Go on. Lord have mercy.
Was able to accept a position as pastor. There was Watts, and there was Vietnam.
We want to welcome you. Chicago is a big town. It likes to welcome big people. And you're one of the biggest. We welcome Martin Luther King, Nobel Prize winner, who fights for the betterment of America. All right-thinking people share his views. And we have a whole schedule for you. A march through the loop to the lakefront, an appearance on the Today Show.
Dr. King didn't come here just to make appearances this time. He came here to talk about jobs and housing and schools.
The schools and housing in Chicago is the best for blacks than any city in the United States.
How much you want for this?
$90 a month. That's a lot, isn't it? Make up your mind. You won't find anything else at any better rates.
take it. And this place pays $90 a month unfurnished.
Mommy, it smells here.
Yoki, we're going to live here for a while. Most of our people live just this way.
You didn't tell me Martin Luther King was in the building.
We're going to live here.
I'll talk to the landlord. He'll get some paint, new furniture, and fix it up a little.
No. We'll take it just as it is. Just as it is.
This way, gentlemen. Come right over here. No, you want to get a picture of that?
Please?
There, take a picture of that right over there. I'm sure you want to have a picture of this right here. Get a picture right over here by this window.
This is our new home.
It's nice of you to visit me. I don't usually get such a distinguished visitor.
And I'm here to ask you to stop telling our people to burn down their own neighborhoods.
That's the last thing I do. They're finding the manhood out there.
And I've watched you for a long time. What else do you have to offer besides hate?
Hate is something to have. Don't you think it's about time our people had hate?
Where does it take
them? It takes them to reality. It lets them know who the enemy is.
So we're no better than they are. They hate, we hate. They use bombs, we use bombs.
Who claims we're any better? You're a racist. You've showed great courage. You've done more to desegregate this country than any man who's ever lived. But you see, it didn't cost this country to integrate the lunch counters and buses and toilets. It didn't cost this country to guarantee the right to vote, but to end the poverty for black people in this country and give them a chance to catch up will cost billions and billions of dollars, and somehow I don't see that being done by appealing to their conscience.
We'll find a way. It'll be nonviolent.
You still believe in the white man, don't you?
I have no choice but to believe in him.
I have a choice. I don't expect him to love me. I don't want his love. I court his hatred. I want no part of his society, no part of his values.
The dreary truth about the white man is that he is as flawed as everybody else. But not only do I object to you on moral grounds, I object to what you're doing on tactical grounds. If it came down to a show of arms, we are only 10% of the population. You are advocating suicide.
Maybe, but it's better than living like this.
Well, there is something else. There is nonviolent resistance.
Are you still talking about Gandhi? You are not Gandhi. You're a middle-class Southern preacher's son.
What I am isn't important. Why don't you use your charisma, your brilliance, to help our people live and not die.
Because they hurt us too much. Because there's no living with him, because he'll lie and deceive us in the end.
The final truth isn't that you hate the white man. You see, you hate being black. You can't see beyond your own personal rejection.
This country respects violence. Sometimes I think it's the only thing that it respects. You hold on to your position, you'll get discredited by your own people. Martin, I can help those demonstrations in Chicago succeed. Modify your stance on nonviolence. We'll appear nationally together. It's the best thing for our people.
I can't.
At least we have one thing in common. We're both dead men. I love you. You may not believe it, but it's true. I love you. You're a glorious fool.
Dr. King?
Never mind about that. Now, just who can I play with? I want to play with the best player.
That's me, Dr.
Hey, no,
King.
No.
Hey,
please.
Don't make up your mind.
That's what. You say, the friend. That's what. Stand up, our friend.
Chin, duck, top, down with Dr. King.
All right.
I believe the doctor is a good pool player.
We're making progress. We've put on 70 new housing inspectors, and we've come up with a list of 125 housing violations. We're going to prosecute those violators.
These aren't the real offenders. They're just small landlords.
Chicago has lasted for a long time. It's a tough city. You're not going to change it overnight.
We found over the long haul, unless it is changed overnight, it'll never be changed.
We agree with all of your aims, Dr. King. It's just a matter of the art of the possible. We represent our constituents, and our constituents are troubled by the demands you're making.
Which demands? Minimum wages, school desegregation, the dispersal of blacks from concentrated areas, the same rental conditions as anybody else?
As I say, we agree with you, but you know what it is? There is talk around town among white workers that the blacks have been getting too much. And they'll soon have their jobs.
But that's because they are cynical people in politics and the press that prey on people's fears that have no foundation. I suppose we have no choice but to recruit as many demonstrators as we can to fill the jails and boycott businesses that discriminate against blacks.
I wouldn't do that. This isn't Birmingham or Selma. You haven't been in Chicago before. There's a certain tradition here. It was the home of Al Capone for years. You know?
What is it now? Dinner's just ready.
May I come in?
Of course.
Hello, Martin.
Hello, V.
Will you stay for dinner?
Oh, I just have a few minutes. I have to go to this meeting at the NAACP.
You better eat. You need your strength.
Sandy, I'm gonna jump off a cliff.
What are you gonna do now? Maybe I can stop you.
Come out against Vietnam?
That's jumping off the cliff.
Somebody has to speak out against it.
As long as you know what it means.
How have you been, Stan?
Fine.
Forgive me.
There's nothing to forgive.
No, I should have kept you on, no matter what.
It was my suggestion that I go.
I need you.
What about the FBI?
I want you to be my friend again.
I always was, Martin.
Well, then let somebody try to make something out of it.
Do you know what you are doing?
Oh, we're just here for the weekend, Dad. Let's enjoy our dinner.
But he's got to know what he's doing. A black man does not venture out and give advice on foreign policy.
I've never thought of myself as just a black leader. Perhaps I should, but I can't.
They can frame you. They can destroy you.
And they've done so much already.